I think I first join all of you wishing India Today Group 30 years anniversary. And also at this point, I should also say there's someone older than India Today who's having a wedding anniversary, or 34th wedding anniversary. That is through Pramod Mahajan. He's celebrating his 34th wedding anniversary. I think his wife has spared him to come and join us here. I think it all goes to Prabhu. I think you made him do that. Honorable through Praful Patel, Minister of State for Civil Aviation. Honorable through Pramod Mahajan, through Harun Puri, Editor-in-Chief of India Today, through Prabhu Chavla, Editor of India Today, distinguished guests, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen. I am honored to be in this august gathering this evening and participate in this interactive session organized by India Today to share thoughts on bridging the infrastructure deficit. Infrastructure is fundamental to the future of our great nation, especially when the world is shrinking owing to the advances in rapid communications. All of us present here are collectively engaging in eliminating distance, whether by physically or digital means. Availability of proper infrastructure across the country also leads to social inclusion of the communities living far and wide, and thus in national integration. This is true national building. Since I'm the first speaker, I shall be sharing with you, as Prabhu said, in the areas concerned of telecom and information technology. The single factor of production that stands out as hallmark of the new millennium is technology, especially knowledge-based ones. Even within these knowledge-based industries, information and communication technology are the driving force of a major new revolution. This is qualitatively different from earlier revolutions, namely industrial and agricultural revolutions, in this rate of change and spread. IT is changing the way we work, communicate, organize, conduct business, gather and process information, and even how we play and entertain. Digital divide can be viewed in four different perspectives. A gap in access to use ICTs, broadly measured by the number and spread of telephones or web-enabled computers, for instance. A gap in the ability to use ICTs, measured by the skills base and the presence of numerous complementary assets. A gap in actual use, the minutes of telecommunication for various purposes, the number and time of online users, the number of internet hosts, and the level of electronic commerce. A gap in impact of use is measured by financial and economic returns. Shortly stated, it is a division of world between those who have access to new information and communication technology and those who do not. I shall try to dwell on these issues. First, let me speak that the telecom infrastructure. This is like the tale of two cities. We have the best of the times and the worst of the times. Today, India, more than 135.5 million telephone network is there, and we have the largest, second largest compared to China in having the second largest network in the world. The wireless sector has overtaken the fixed line services. And if you ask, have we bridged the digital divide? That's a big question. Our overall tele-density is 12%. However, this is skewed. Urban-rural divide is evident. Urban tele-density is respectively 36%. Delhi, as of the IS, has got 60% tele-density. Chennai has got 57%. Mumbai is 53%. But the rural tele-density is very low at 1.9%. Rural India is crying for more coverage and infrastructure. We have plans to add 250 million lines by 2007. And we are very hopeful by 2010, we'll add 500 million lines. Would this eliminate digital divide? This translates only to 22% in 2007 and around 45% by 2010. The skewness of the rural-urban divide will still be there. I thought at this moment I should share with you a small story, which an incident which happened to me when I my recent visit to US. In San Jose, I had an opportunity to address the venture capitalists of Americans and ask them to come and invest in India. So it was a nice informal meeting. So an American gentleman asked, just stood up and said, Mr. Maran, you want us to come and invest in India? Last week, I made a trip and back from India. Why do you want me to invest? I was quite shocked when I was going in the car. I happened to see a sight which shocked me. A man was taking a cow for a walk in the middle of the road. And you want me to come and invest in telecom in India? I said, sir, you had me. I have no answers to say, nothing to say on that. But I should also mention, did he look at the man closely? She was a little shocked. I said, why am I saying that? He said, why? Did you look at him closely? The left hand might be holding the rope. The right hand must be holding a cellular phone. And he was talking in his way. And if that's way, that's how India is growing. Believe me or not, that's exactly how India is growing. Today, our population wants it now. I am also part of that population who's young and always believes that things should happen faster. And thankfully, the sector which I'm handling, both the IT and the telecom sector, is growing at that speed. In fact, this morning, I had an opportunity to have meet the Prime Minister of Finland, who was in Chennai, to inaugurate the first telecom equipment factory, Nokia, in Chennai. And it was quite nice to hear that when he said that Nokia has come to India, and it's the 10th factory of Nokia in the world, and it's happening in India. At that time, he was mentioning about his country, and he said, I come from a country with a population of 5.2 million. So when my turn came, he said, sir, I'm happy to say, in the month of January, we added Finland population to Indian population. And that's the way I'm saying the growth, the numbers are astonishing, the way we are growing. And as you said, in fact, it surprises us that every Indian, every day, and I think India Today report was saying every, the calculations is, we are adding 1.6 lakhs new subscribers every day. That is the kind of numbers which we are adding in the telecom sector. And in fact, we have realized that the growth cannot be stopped. Right now, 12% tele-density is growing up and up, and as I mentioned earlier, when we even reached 22% in 2007, we are planning to have 250 million subscribers. It is not enough. And today, we have created a new market. People like carpenters, whom you said, they have no phones. Now, even though people in this room will definitely give a phone to the drivers just to make sure they come and pick you up or come in time to where to pick you up at the office, but India is changing. The urban India, which constitutes 70% of the population, is still lagging behind. As part of the public sector units of BSNL and MTNL, they're going ahead with well, a very ambitious order of 60 million lines to be added by the next 2-3 years. And more than 70% of the lines are going to be added in rural India. And in fact, I also feel the private operators who are competing apple to apple with BSNL have ensured that this takes place much more faster and do it quicker. In fact, as I came, took over as the Minister of Communication and Information Technology, the only thing I've been doing is opening the gates, removing the barriers. Today, the cost per minute is 2 cents per minute. It's the lowest in the world. Today, we have one India. Today, we have one India. When I announced, what, 7 months back, people looked at me very suspiciously. What is this guy going to do? One India? One rate? What is it? Is it possible? But the one has caught the imagination of the people. Today, 1 rupee is not only offered by BSNL or MTNL. It is offered by Hatel, it is offered by Hutch, it is offered by Reliance. Every private operator is joining it. And that's what we wanted. We wanted all these players in this arena to come out with a competitive plan. And when all of them start competing against each other in a fair way, the consumer seems to be the lucky one. He seems to be getting the best. But eventually, in this competition, one good thing is happening. The market is growing. That means the competition is fueling the growth in infrastructure, and we are ensuring that it is spreading. And take it from me. The space in the cities is shrinking. There's no elbow room for big operators to cut new customers in the cities. They are now forced to go to rural areas, which they are very sure will try to get them the connectivity. And at this point, I also want to like to mention that when we are looking at a telecom growth, the question which arises for me is that we are planning to have 250 million subscribers, then what are we going to do? Are we going to import all these equipments into our country? This is when we decided, and BSNL, MTNL came with a nice smart plan. We said that 30% of those equipment, the value addition has to be made within our country. End of the day, I do believe made in India is always better than made in any other part of the world. And as I said, today is a proud day for me when Nokia is setting up a plant in India, in Chennai. Last week, Samsung wanted to overtake Nokia. They set up a plant in Gurgaon. And this is what we want. We want manufacturing to come into India. As soon as this order starts, I'm sure we'll find Ericsson, Motorola, everyone opening up a shop and giving employment to our people. And this is what, end of the day, we want. And another part, when I come to the information technology, I'm sure Nathan is here, the leaders and pioneers in the industry. They have all taken India made so proud. If I'm respected in the anywhere outside India, it's first they look at me very suspiciously, a young guy, a minister. Then they say, what minister are you? I say, okay, I'm minister for communication and IT. IT, that's it. Then I get a different respect because they look at me, okay, something is good about this guy. No wonder India is doing well. So I tried, Nandan, thanks to you guys. I try to capitalize that. And IT is something which is growing. And today, I think we are doing an export of $23 billion. And NASSCOM is very, very confident that there'll be an addition of 30% every year. But an important question arises. And the same question every software company in India has. How much of the software does the Indian use? Very, very minimal. And the government realizes that, and just then I decided that the government should first start using software by using it in a large scale so that the other Indian companies start using them. And this is the plan we decided, and we decided to go when we said, if you have to reach a village, you need a road. If you want information to reach a village, you need bandwidth, you need fiber connectivity. This is when last year we started the statewide area network. We have spent nearly, we have budgeted about 3,300 crores for that, and we have started. All the states have started putting up the network up to the block level. It was quite not too ambitious. We want up to 2 Mbps bandwidth to be reached up to the block level, and we have succeeded in doing that. Now, we decide to roll out the e-governance plan. And what we wanted the e-governance plan? We wanted a menu card which is simple for the citizen. We want the government services to be delivered to our citizen at their doorsteps. And how do you proceed to do it? We said, India has got 600,000 villages. It is not possible to connect all the villages. We took 100,000 villages and shaped them in the shape of honeycomb. That is, you have one village and five villages surrounding that. And what do Indians want? The first thing we want is our community certificate. We want a death certificate. We want a birth certificate. We want a land document. We want to pay our taxes. So we took about 26 services, which a common Indian use, instead of making being very ambitious and putting 120 and not delivering them. And we decided we'll have called them the common service centers, which will be situated in a village closer to a person. So if I'm living in a village, the maximum distance I have to go is to the next village or to my village. We plan to do this e-governance service, and we plan to start for 100,000 villages, and we are planning to do complete it by 2007. And we are sure that when we do this, we will make sure that our citizens who are living in the rural area is able to get their services. In fact, today, land documents in most of the states is available within a day's time. But we want to reduce this time to make within an hour or less than that. And we want to make it in a public-private partnership mode. In fact, I believe very strongly when it goes in a public-private partnership mode, it is much more faster. There's an ownership there, and the people will definitely do it when there's an income for the person who's operating the system. This is what we think. I feel we can do it. And simultaneously, we also believe that the revolution of telecom, internet, plays a vital role. But there are three C's to internet, which has made the major barriers for internet. First is the connectivity. Do you have a good connectivity and cheap connectivity? This is what we started rolling down. We started coming out the broadband policy of 2004. When he said, let's start working on broadband, let's first define what the hell is broadband. Because no one, everyone was calling whatever, even a 64 kbps as broadband. We said, let's make, say, 256 kbps as broadband and anything about that. With that, we announced a broadband policy. Today, I'm happy to say we have more than 1 million broadband users in our country. This is a great achievement for us because we are all, we have started a very nice way. Today, broadband is doing, and we have the lowest broadband prices. When we started, 256 kbps was costing somewhere around 3,000 rupees. Today, MTNL is offering for 199, and BSNL is giving for 250 rupees. So this is the way it is going. And today, BSNL and MTNL are so aggressive, if you have a dial-up users, they come to you, they bug you. They give a free demonstration and say, you take it and use it for a week, and probably you'll shift to a broadband from a dial-up users. The cost has come down. And also, we have been also seeing the connectivity. Next is the content. Everyone thinks outside India, every Indian speaks English. Every Indian writes English. They know how to converse very well. But the truth is that less than 5% of the Indians know how to speak and write in English. This is the fact. I always keep telling the people that India is a diverse country. We are like Europe. Each state is different. We have 22 official languages and more than 1,000 dialects. And we realize that since most of the content is in English, the reason for dial-up users to convert to a broadband is very minimal because they use the internet only to receive emails. And basically, our cost of labor is so low, I can still send a person to go buy a ticket for and stay for 4 or 5 hours in the queue and still do it. But today, things are changing. We are planning to get the content. In fact, my department is trying to work very closely to get an Indian language browser. Basically, what we are saying is, whatever content is in English, if I want in Gujarati or Tamil or Marathi, I just choose the language and it tries to convert, that, translate into that. This is a dream. I feel that we should do that. The moment we do that, we'll have a purpose for the person to use a computer for that he gets a good content. And I should also say at this moment, although Laluji could not make it today, today we have the railways doing online ticketing for more than 300 crores an annum. In fact, Deccan Aviation is doing 1,000 crores e-ticketing in there to their e-ticketing thing. It's a big thing, and we can see that the way India is changing. And I say that these are the efforts which has happened, and of course, the price of the computers. This is one sector which I had to bully the manufacturers because the government has no control over it. But I should say the manufacturers came out voluntarily, and today we have the first sub 10,000 computers available in our country. This is a great deal, I feel that, because nowhere in the world you have computers less than for $220. But when I found that, I asked them, because they said everyone wants to come and buy a sub 10,000 computer. When they come to buy the computers, they realize that they go for add-on, and it still goes for 12 or 13,000 rupees. So there's always an add-on factor. But this is what we are doing in the computer sector. And also I said, in the field of ICT, today we are very, very proud that we are exporting a lot of software. But companies like Infosys are opening up shop in China also. Although one side they do good for our country, but they're also exposing what they do in our country to China. And believe me that China has taken the software business very, very seriously. In fact, I'm told that they are also ready to give labor subsidies for a period of up to 1 year. This is what I'm told. I'm not able to confirm that. But do understand, if we are going to be in the bottom of the food chain, just to very minimal BPO services, it's a matter of time that we lose it out to China. We have to go up, carry on the, climb the value chain, and move for advanced VLSI designs. There's a complaint, and we also realize that we produce a good amount of 350,000 engineering graduates every year, but they come out raw, and they get absorbed in the companies. But the companies have to spend a lot of time, qualitative time, in training them to get used to them. But we feel that the government should also working with the industry. And what we want to do is make sure, train, bring in new curriculums so that when the students are studying, the government should be able to identify what are the new technologies coming in, and so as to ensure that we give them the correct training and our industry has an edge, a comparative edge on this. And as I felt that when our country is growing, we are able to take care of telecom, ICTs. One sector of manufacturing which is very close to me and which has come to reality in this budget speech of the finance minister, as I said, we are expected to consume nearly $33 billion worth of semiconductors in next by 2015. But are we manufacturing semiconductors within the country? The answer is no. We are importing them from China, Taiwan, Singapore, and Malaysia. I was able to track some interest in this area. Today, we have a tie-up with AMD and Sem India to manufacture semiconductors in India. And they are planning, and the government of India is also now planning to join them, because anywhere in the world, any country, or be it any government, they fund, they subsidize the big semiconductor investment, because they are a $3 billion investment. And I'm happy to know that the finance minister, in a speech, has proposed the existing vehicles of viability gap funding with India Infrastructure Finance Company Limited. This will give a major boost, and we are very clear, we don't want only semiconductors. The other filling the blanks are manufacturing of LCDs, OLEDs, and plasma panel displays and storage devices. We should complete the full chain if we have to compete with China. If we have to make ourselves self-contained, we have to make sure that we are filling that blank. I'm sure that India, we are taking the right steps. And I should say this, I know it's political, but under the leadership of our Prime Minister and by the advisory of Mrs. Sonia Gandhi, India is trying to fill in the gaps, and we're doing it fast. If you ask me, will we be able to do it in the remaining 3 years? I will say no. But we are making an earnest effort, make sure that we have started, be it my ministry, or be it Praful, or be it Laluji. We are making ensure, and we are listening. The voices of the young Indians are heard, and we are listening, and we are working towards filling in the gap as fast as possible. But this cannot be done in 1 day. But this cannot be done in 10 years. But we should start. At least I'm happy to say we have started and we are moving fast. I thank this India Today for giving me this opportunity to come and express myself. Thank you very much.
Good evening, friends. I'd especially first like to wish the India Today group a very happy 30th birthday or anniversary, whatever you want to call it. Celebrations. And as Dayanidhi, I should also not forget Pramodji. A very, very happy wedding anniversary to you. Friends, these are exciting times, as my friend Dayanidhi has just spelled out mind-boggling numbers, and they really catch your imagination sometimes, even beat your imagination, and all these things are actually possible in our very own India. Because not very far ago, we used to really be yearning for attention, yearning for getting the country on track or in tune with what's happening with the rest of the world. I also remember a time, because most of you here sitting are businessmen, that to talk to a businessman about a billion-dollar company was something like a dream. Most Indian businessmen were fascinated by $1 billion, whether it be of revenue or market capitalization or whatever. But in the last few years, I would say that the whole world is fascinated by another billion, and that is 1 billion Indian people. And I would say, to the credit of our own people, it is their enterprise, it is their, I would say, determination that has put the country on this high growth trajectory. In fact, to me personally, infrastructure, Prabhu, as you rightly mentioned, has been one of the subjects dearest to my heart. And as a person coming from a business background myself, I have always been wondering why our country has lagged behind in sector after sector for no real reason. Actually, we really don't think that the government is required to fund everything or the government is required to build everything. That used to be a mindset. It still is in many ways. But that's quickly changing. And as a result, we are seeing the gains emerging, but still not enough. In fact, I'm thoroughly disappointed. I'm not talking about any ministry, but as a country, that why we still have to go without power for more than 12 hours in village after village of our country. Why even in a city like Mumbai or even in Delhi, you see power cuts now as routine as just about anything else? Why in our country we could not build roads, why we could not have the ports or the airports or just about every single area of infrastructure building which we have not been able to deliver for so many years. And therefore, when I had this opportunity, I really thank the Lord because I was committed to doing something which was close to my heart, and that was infrastructure. I happened to be in the right place at the right time. I don't know whether I'm the right person, but at least I happened to be in the right team and in the right environment. And that exactly is something which India needs to build up infrastructure in the shortest possible time. I'm sure a lot of the other things will fall into place brick by brick. There is a great drive in India. There's a great determination in India. There is a great, I would say, desire in India to build up our country. And it's not just because of the government. I'm sure, as Dayanidhi himself will agree, that the IT industry, as you rightly pointed out, really gives, it's like a toast to India. I think it's happened all because, not because of government, but in spite of government. Pramodji, you've been a minister there. And it's been in spite of government. And I think many a sector, I sometimes wonder, and I just reflect, and I've not been in the government or in the ministry for far too long. It's just been 22 months. Actually, we should keep counting the months because in coalition politics, we never know how many more months are left to go. But anyway, with 22 months also, I think it's too far back in history that I'm going back and trying to go into the numbers. But it is something which has defied all conventional wisdom and logic why this sector has not been allowed to grow or to develop to its fullest potential. And even as everybody in India is suddenly, like the telecom sector, fascinated with what's happening in aviation, I myself wonder what immense potential there is still ahead of us. I don't even think we have scratched the tip of the iceberg. And if you just want to go into numbers, I'll just give you a few statistics because that, as now Dayanidhi has gone into statistics, I must also copy him a little bit. But that's the statistics are of India. That's the fascination of a billion people. That's what I mentioned. The statistics all stem out of the great Indian population, which at one time we considered it a huge liability, considered it a huge drain on our people or on the country. But today it is actually turning out to be a great asset and which we have to exploit. No asset can be really an asset unless you've exploited it to its fullest potential. And therefore in aviation, we have just about 200 civilian aircraft in the whole country. No matter what we talk of, growing airlines, number of airlines, growing passengers, there are just 200 aircraft in India. When I joined, there were about 150 aircraft. Captain Satish Sharma is sitting here. He will bear me out with all the numbers if I'm wrong. But with 200 aircraft, we are suddenly fascinated. Do you know the population is 1.1 billion, but the number of people who actually fly in our country, the base is only 10 million people. And if 10 million people either fly once a year or many times a year like all of us, that's only, I would say, not even 0.5% of the population. And the immense potential, what is ahead of us, if only 100 million people flew once a year, do you know India would require at least 2,000 aircraft? With 200 aircraft, I don't know where to park them. I refuse permissions every day. And everybody is fighting with me that I want my slot. There's one airline entrepreneur here, Thyagarajan. So I, Paramount Airways. But I can see Indian Airlines here. I can see others. Maybe they're not visible to my eye. But every single day, my biggest challenge is whether I can allot an aircraft bay to A airline or B airline or C airline. This is with 200 aircraft. If only, as I said, 10 times the increase, which is absolutely possible because the kind of middle class which we have, at least 300 million by your statistics, Mr. Chawla, a disposable income growing, I'm sure you have more numbers. But if this went to 2,000 planes, it could happen within 5 years, it could happen within 10 years. I can be very sure it can happen in less. The reason is only infrastructure. People are there, the demand is pent up. We had To give you statistics again, we had only 20 flights a week between India and the UK for, I don't know, God number of years. And we had an artificial cap. Everybody used to be wanting somebody's influence to get a seat into going into London and back. In less than a year time, since we signed a new bilateral with the United Kingdom, we already have more than 120 flights a week between India and the UK, and still the seat factor remains the same. And by next year, I can assure you, there'll be at least 200 flights a week between India and the UK, and you'll still not be getting the seats. That I can assure you from now. The kind of, I can give you the statistics. When I saw the figures, I myself was astounded. Between January 2005 versus January 2006, the growth was 41% on a year's basis. And if I would, you know, hazard to, you know, give statistics of the growth in the future, I am conservatively saying that Indian aviation can grow compounded 25% year on year for the next 10 years at least. And if we go by these statistics of the United States with a population of not more than 350 million or so, and if United States has a population of aircraft of at least 7,500, and West Europe has a population of aircraft of 5,000, I cannot see India being far away from at least West Europe in the next 10 years. And what do you need to get to that place? You need aviation infrastructure. Simple, I told you about the parking bays. And that is the single biggest challenge. And I really do not feel that, I mean, I have never understood why we have artificially capped our aviation infrastructure at the levels which we have. For how many years, since 1998, Pramodji, I'm not talking about politics, but since 1998, we've decided that we will not spend a single rupee in Mumbai and Delhi, only for the simple reason that we are going to go in for a joint venture. And since 98, the passenger population, the kind of traffic growth, has completely defied all logic, and we have been cribbing as to why we should be spending money on these airports. And the simple solution, and I agree with Dayanidhi on one issue, that to spur competition, to spur growth, we must be able to go in for a public-private partnership mode. We cannot depend on governments to deliver all the things for us. It has to be an era of giving people more choice, more freedom, and that will give them better service, better rates, and that is reflected in sector after sector. If One India is a success, and if aviation is emerging as one of the success stories of the future, I think the simple logic to that has been there is more choice and there is more competition. And unshackling of this sector is a must. I cannot imagine when I go abroad, I go to Dubai or I go to Singapore, I sometimes come back and wonder, what have I gone there and seen? I mean, okay, if I work and I go as a businessman, it's fine. But if I have to go as a tourist, and which most Indians, they pick up a flight, shortest destination, they want to go and enjoy, or they want to go and shop, they go to Dubai or they go to Singapore. And I come back from there and I wonder, no reflection to the countries involved, but what have I seen? I've gone to the desert in Dubai and I go and see some steel and glass towers, I go and see artificially built the palms, or I go and see the Burj Al Arab, for which, not for me, but for most people, they have to pay an entry fee to go and see that hotel. And when you come back and you wonder, what have I done? What did I go and see? There's nothing. You go to Singapore and every tourist goes and flocks into the Sentosa Island. And you come back and wonder, what have you seen in Sentosa Island? I mean, you really have to wonder and scratch your head. Whereas you go to Mumbai, none of us or no tourist is able to go to the Elephant Island, which actually has so much more to offer, Anand, but we have not marketed it right. No, none of us go. Why should anybody else from abroad go there? The packaging is simply not right. Can you imagine, we talk of tourism, and we talk of, no, India cannot be complete without the Taj Mahal, I'm sure. And can you believe, even as I talk with all with my enthusiasm and my passion, we don't have a single flight from Delhi to Agra as I talk today to you. Not even one. And why should Delhi or Agra not be connected with at least 100 flights a day? Why should it not be? Why should somebody, most of you are businessmen, you have associates who come from overseas, when they land in Delhi, they finish their day's work, it may end at 3 o'clock, why can't, and he has a flight at 3 o'clock in the night to go to London or wherever, to his next destination, why can't he be able to just pick a flight, go to Agra, see the Taj Mahal and come back and again take his flight back into wherever he wants to go? I'm sure that will add value, but we have just not thought of it. Our airports have never been designed for having a transit flight. Have you ever thought of anywhere in the world that you have an international airport 5 miles away from the domestic airport, and to go to it you have to spend more money than probably coming from the city to your own airport? Where in the world have you seen this? But we've planned our airports like that. Have you ever heard of anybody going from London to Tokyo and telling his secretary that I need to transit out of some Asian destination? Nobody, even we don't even thinking of Delhi or Mumbai or any Indian airport as a transit airport to go into any other place. We will also pick up our phone and say, check whether there's a flight out of Dubai, there's a flight out of Singapore, nowadays even out of Bangkok or even Kuala Lumpur. But nobody ever looks at India as even a transit destination. Do you know that Singapore and Dubai, virtually 60% of their entire traffic at the airport is transit traffic. And they make their big bucks out of that. The airlines make big money out of that. But we have simply ignored all conventional logic and wisdom, and we've gone about doing what we think we are right about, and we, as in the bargain, we've lost out on a great deal of things. And tourism, I personally believe that bringing one aircraft is not... No, is not just, you know, bringing one plane into the country. It is about the multiplier effect. If 200 planes can do so much for India's tourism and for India's economy, can you imagine what 2,000 or 5,000 planes can do for India's economy? It is just completely, there are no numbers to actually authenticate what I'm actually trying to, the point I'm trying to make. Even with this kind of growth, what we see, you don't get a room. Nandan will tell me in Bangalore, this is the most expensive city in the country or in the world probably to get a hotel room. The infrastructure is not just about airports and about telecom, Dayanidhi, my friend. It is also that the government must look at this also equally meaningfully. If you are not able to provide, where in the world are you going to get tourists if every tourist has to pay $200 or $300 to stay in a hotel in a country? It's absolutely not possible to sustain that kind of growth. So the end result is we have to look at our infrastructure. We have to look at the numbers. And there is a complete, I think, metamorphosis which is going to take place in the aviation sector, I can assure you. Do you know, we only talk about planes and passengers. N.K. Singh is sitting here, who was associated with many a good thing about aviation and the reports and the foundation of aviation which has been set up. But tell me, has anybody in this country thought of agro exports or our commodity exports or the cargo business in aviation? Do you know a country as big as India has only 4 small aircraft for cargo operations? Only 4 operated by Blue Dart, and all 4 Indian Airlines sold the planes and they bought and converted and they're flying them. Can you imagine, for a country of our size, we are a sixth of humanity, the size of the country. As Dayanidhi, you're talking of one India and making 1 rupee and the phone call and making people feel that they are part of, I'm sure telecom will go down in history as one of the best integrators of the nation. Pramodji, you also have a role to play as a former communications minister. You have set the tone. He is taking it forward, and I feel personally that the next best integrator for this country can be aviation. Why does anybody sitting in Nagaland, why will he feel with any association with somebody in Kerala? For him to go from Nagaland to Kerala probably costs more money and has more flight connections. He'll miss 5 times, he'll have to change a plane from somewhere to somewhere, and going by our record, he's bound to miss at least 3 of the 5 flights. And still, you want somebody in India to feel that, yes, he is part of India. Yes, voice has reduced distances. The internet, the communication, your channels have all reduced distances. But the physical distance cannot be removed even by Laluji's trains. No matter how many garib ruts we have, yes, it's a great challenge, it's a great turnaround for the railways. And do you know also the statistics that the railways carry, what the railways carry in a day, we carry in a whole year. So there was other statistics. We have to bridge that. If it costs more money and time to go from Nagaland to Kerala than from going from Nagaland to London or to Bangkok or to any other place in the world, and more money, we will have to look at this also constructively. And that's why more airlines, more planes coming, we have to build up regional connectivity. We are just working on a policy, and we want to build up this regional connectivity concept. No more can you just have an airline going from X point to Y point. Do you know that even today, that most of this growth in aviation is only on the established city pairs and the linkages which have been there traditionally? More flights between Mumbai, Delhi, or Mumbai, Hyderabad, or Delhi, Bangalore, or whatever. But new cities, do you know Indian cities, and our Indian cities are no small, all cities are upwards of 1 million and 2 million. For the world, it is, you know, when we talk of big cities, and our small cities are also, thanks to that population boom which we have. But the thing is that we have not yet connected new cities. City after city, nowadays in Parliament, there are more questions for the aviation than for railways, because now the aspirational level of the young Indian has moved. 50% of India is anyway 25 years and below. So the whole aspirational change has to be reflected in the way we work, the way we address the problems. And that's the real challenge. We have to address it in the shortest possible time. Frustration should not set in. As we have done it in the case of the airports of Mumbai and Delhi, we stood firm. We were committed. We saw reason in it. There was nothing to hurt anybody's interest. It was an issue for the either we look after the interest and not the interest. Everybody's interest in terms of jobs is protected. But do we look at 2,500 people or do we look at the interest of 1 billion+ people? The answer was to look after the interest of 1 billion people. And no matter what the odds, we had to achieve it. And Mumbai, Delhi, my friend Dayanidhi is already prodding me. He's already fighting with me. What about my Chennai? He wants everything in Chennai. We'll give it to you in Chennai. Why not? Every city, every state, every province must have more connectivity. Why should the government come in the way? If you want to build an airport, please build one happily. That should be the approach of the government. That should be the approach. It's your land, it's your money, it's your machine. Why should I come in the way? That is exactly what is going to be the shape of aviation in the future. We really don't need a minister for civil aviation. In 5 years, we should make it the Department of Civil Aviation. That is what we should be working at. And that can be done. It's absolutely achievable. In the next few years, you will see Indian airports, not in Mumbai and Delhi alone, but across the country, Indians will be proud to travel wherever they are by plane, and they will hold their heads high to the rest of the world. We will be in the age of world-class effort. And we will make good airports, world-class airports in Varanasi or in Khajuraho or in Dibrugarh or in Trichy.
Better than Ahmedabad.
Better than Ahmedabad. Well, I am only a Patel from Gujarat, but I am in Maharashtra. So my loyalty is to Pramod ji and myself. But we have to do it. How can we sustain this kind of a thing? And we are going in for this great change, whether it's regional connectivity, whether it's for building up cargo capacity. Why should a country not have cargo planes? There should be as many cargo planes flying in India as there are passenger planes. We're going to come with new policies for that, incentivize them. We're going to incentivize people to fly. We're going to incentivize airlines to come in. We want no new airports to be built in this country. Again, as you rightly pointed out, aviation alone can be an engine for growth in terms of job creation. As the IT industry, the communication industry, as sector after sector has built new jobs, the young Indian who comes out of schools and colleges has to be given the right kind of environment, the employment opportunities, and that is also going to be coming out of aviation. I do not hazard a guess wrongly, but at least aviation in the next 10 years and the related activities will throw in at least 20 lakh new jobs. And that is what is required. We've done research on this. We will take this meaningfully forward, and notwithstanding all the odds, political or otherwise, we will take the aviation agenda ahead. My friend, the High Commissioner of Pakistan, is smiling in appreciation. We will have more flights with you also. Inshallah, we're not going to be leaving you behind. We'd rather leave you behind in other things, not in aviation. But we will ensure a good partnership. We have to work together. We have to live together. We have to develop together. This region is in for great prosperity. As an Indian, I feel genuinely very proud. Wherever I go, India's stock is high. India is flying high, and I have to also make it fly high. Thank you very much.
Once Mr. Churchill was asked, what are the three most difficult things in life? He said, one, climbing a wall which is leaning towards you. Two, kissing a woman which is leaning away from you. Anyway, what else I can say on 34th wedding anniversary? And third, speaking before an audience which is more interested in dinner to be served than your speech. Maran has taken more time than is route ki sabhi line west hai. And Praful was hovering over Delhi for 2 hours. Sometimes I feel that we Indians are so starved of development that even signing a contract, we start opening a champagne bottle as if we already got the airport. So my job here is that both the most efficient ministers, because Prabhu has brought up, I'm seeing Karan sitting here, so normally you have best actor prizes. You don't have worst actor prizes because they don't turn up. No, this is no comment to Lalu. So, the best two actors of this government, in all true sense, have presented their case. I'm here to tell you the reality of the infrastructure. Because sometimes I feel that if you see only petals of a rose, you are optimistic. If you see only thorns, you are pessimistic. But if you see both of them together, then you are realistic. I want to be realistic. As far as the aviation sector is concerned, Prabhu was thinking, people may think why I am called here. I'm connected to both the sectors. And sometimes I can say that as far as the aviation boom in this country is concerned, and now I have to self-propagate myself, I have more contribution to make than what Prabhu is trying to make. He's trying to make it, is yet to be seen. Because I remember in 1994, When the private airlines came into this country, they were called as air taxi operators. They were not even allowed to publish the timetables because we had a law which bestowed upon Indian Airlines and Air India the monopoly in Indian skies. And there was a loophole, as every law has, to have some kind of air taxi operator, and then east-west and jet started working. The then Minister Madhavrao Sindhia tried to introduce a bill to take away this monopoly of Indian Airlines and Air India. And BJP opposed it. Now, normally, nowadays we all support Indian Airlines. But when I became minister, we always used to abuse Indian Airlines because it was the only airline. And then Madhura was not a minister. After that, Gulam Nabi came. And accidentally, I became the minister, the chairman of transport committee. And he sought my help. And then I convinced my BJP friends, and we submitted a report to take away the monopoly of Indian Airlines and Air India, so that these all airlines can become the scheduled airlines. And that was much before Praful signed the agreement for two airports. That was the only government initiative taken long back in 1994 to make the Indian skies free. Now, what happened in 10 years, and I'm not blaming him, though he said that, Pramod, you see, politics can't go out of anybody. He said, Pramod, you know, I don't want to play politics. From 98, nobody sanctioned a pie to Mumbai airport. Now, I did not know. He inaugurated recently a terminal from where the money came. It did not come in last 22 months. It's a continued process. But I don't want to go into that. The question comes that airlines started coming and we had a mismatch with the airport. And at no point of time we ever thought how to match. Now, as he really saying that 200 aircrafts, now 2,000 will come. Now he promised even Khajuraho world-class airport. So it's a very long way to go. Unfortunately, we are Indians. And so we are not Chinese who can build two Shanghai airport in 3 years. So let your airport be completed in your term. I wish you every success to continue as minister and get it inaugurated, because it's very difficult. Sometimes as minister, no, we marry pregnant brides. And we celebrate somebody else's success. In last one decade, from two state-owned airlines, we have gone to 12. And Praful tells me half a dozen are waiting. I would request you that we should not reach in 1953 situation. Right from Gulam Nabi, I have told, liberalization doesn't mean that you purchase one aircraft and start an airline. That is not liberalization. Nowhere in the world 20 airlines can work. It never happens. So someday we have to find out. Otherwise, it's very easy, because wet lease, dry lease is available. And so there are many challenges before you as far as aviation is concerned. I want to show some thorns, so I don't want to rub petals. I congratulate Dayanidhi Maran. He's doing an excellent job in last 22 months as far as the telecom sector is concerned. But all of us know, whether aviation, where you have 200 aircrafts, only Praful has ordered new aircrafts. Otherwise, all these aircrafts have come from private sector. Similarly, in telecom sector also, if you look at 94, it's all from 94 to 2006. These are the 12 years. When? Sukhram started it. And then came one policy, the another policy, the third policy, the fourth policy. I don't have to take names, Maran, because I don't survive on leaders, so I don't have to take names. But there were many prime ministers who came and went and added something to this telecom sector, took risk, and today we are seeing blooming of this sector. And I, as a former minister, appreciate, and publicly I'm ready to appreciate, that you are taking this relay race even little more faster than what we did in the past, and I really congratulate to you. But at the same time, let me say only two things. One, as far as information technology is concerned, it is neither a technology nor a business. Information technology is neither a technology nor a business. It is the fourth generation of human communication. When we came on this earth, first communication was gestures. Then came the sound. Then came the written language. Now it is digital language. It is the combination of earlier three. All video, audio, everything combined. And so this is the new language. And though the numbers which you say and which all of us are proud of make us proud, but when you go by percentage-wise, that in 1 billion people having computers, people how to know, open email, then I think it's a very long way to go. Because I'm afraid, we have to bridge the deficit, I'm afraid Americans might forgot how to write. Because they are going all on email. And so any communication, written communication with the advanced world will almost become impossible. And if we want Indians to be communicative, I think you have a long way to go. One more friendly suggestion to you, not an advice. Mr. Junior Mittal is sitting here. My only complaint against telecom sector is, friends, you have touched the sky as far as quantity is concerned. You are still not international standard as far as your quality is concerned. If you don't agree with me, send me a happy holy message. It will reach me in Diwali. Having talked about these two most successful sectors, I would very fastly would like to touch upon two challenges. I don't want to call it unsuccessful. Whether your aviation or your mobile phone, what you need in this country, the biggest challenge of infrastructure is power. We have to electrify the nation. Now, Praful rightly doing a good airport from Mumbai. We all Mumbaikers feel proud of you. But the next day we read in the newspaper that Mumbai will face 20% power cut in summer. We have never imagined that Mumbai will ever have a power cut. Our demand and supply shortfall is 9%. We have the highest transmission and distribution losses. 75% of the small and medium entrepreneurs in this country depend upon generators. The slogans of the government are save power. I really don't understand. I'm a student of science. You can't save power. How can you save the power? Power has to be instantly used. I can't save power. I will keep darkness tonight, so tomorrow is my wedding anniversary, so I will get few more lights. You can't do that. generated power not used is wasted. It's like a five-star hotel room. The night gone, the room gone. It is useless. It's zero. But instead of spend power, government is advising us save power. We have gone to 100,000 megawatt in last 50 years. China has gone to 600,000 megawatts. Now, I was feel proud when I read Hindustan Times that we have three times more billionaires than Chinese. They have eight, we have 23. And all of us felt proud for somebody else's money. No, I was more worried that I should have more power than China instead of billionaires than China. And here I would like to say that privatization is not the only way. Anyhow, we have done it the wrong way. We started privatizing generation. We should have started privatizing distribution first, transmission later, and generation last. We started privatizing generation. We have a private power project and generated power. Nobody knows who will purchase it. So we went the other way around. But anyway, whatever has happened. But today I think the state has to come forward to create power. One more power, roads. Because Praful flies in the sky with a machine. Maran is borderless. He doesn't need even a machine. So, but most of Indians travel on roads. So world-class airports are not enough. That's not enough infrastructure. Now, India has 3.32 million kilometer roads, out of which hardly 66,000 roads are national highways, 2%. And our 40% of transport goes on this 2% roads. Now we, and I hope both of you will take relay race, you will ask other ministers to take the relay race forward. We had an excellent program, we called it as NHDP. Because we did not name by persons, so naturally we thought it National Highway Development Program. So we called it. We decided that in this golden quadrangle, which includes Chennai, sir, we decided to get best roads, 5,846 kilometers. Within 2 years, we delivered 2,801 kilometers. And in last 2 years, 493 kilometers. The remaining is 2,552. Where are these roads? We had an excellent program. All of you know, Praful must be knowing it. Pradhan Mantri Gramin Sadak Yojana. It was named after Pradhan Mantri. So any Pradhan Mantri could have claimed success for it. But in present government, Pradhan Mantris are not allowed to claim the success. So, and so that Yojana seems to be dropped. I don't know what is happening to this Pradhan Mantri. Now, can we not Indians build up? Yes, we can build up. We have the metro in Delhi. We have Mumbai-Pune Express Highway built up during regime of one government. We could build up in Mumbai 33 flyovers, one flyover per month. We could do it. But this road sector is waiting. I don't want to go on and on because then you'll think that too many, and there are too many foreigners sitting here, so this high-fly Indian tricolor, so nobody said that this opposition leader is trying to bring it down and down and down. So I don't want to. But sir, last thing, this urban development is one infrastructure we should not forget. 40% Indians are living in urban area. There's nothing like rural urban. Forget about it. All rural India is coming to urban India. Because in the villages, you have nothing to export. And when you have nothing to export, you export the population. Bangladesh does it. So does the Indian villages. And so naturally, we have to see, look at the slums from the airport. Why Praful can't make a best airport? Because half of his land is occupied by slum. He can't vacate it because his colleague MP will not allow him to do. Now this is slum, India slum. When I went first to UK on their invitation, so I was from Mumbai, so I said I want to see slums and how you develop. So they showed me something. And then I sat with these city councillors, so I asked them one small question. How do you define a slum? Now, he said, slum. He said, slum is an apartment which is not fully air-conditioned and there is not 24 hours hot and cold water supply. I said, with this logic, Taj Palace is a slum. Now we have changed Surat. We have changed Surat, we have changed Thane, we have changed Nagpur. So it is not that we can't change the cities, the urban area. This one great infrastructure you need. You need water management. This water bottle is as costly as petrol. Slowly the gap between water and petrol, you can't put it in car. You can't drink petrol. Both have same prices. You can't mix even. Now, we had an excellent program. Now, Dayanidhi fights for Kaveri, rightly so. We had an excellent program of connecting Ganga with Kaveri. A river connectivity. I don't know what has happened to that program. I don't hear it. Water is life. Beer, champagne is all extra. Thirst of water cannot be met with any other liquid. And so this kind of a river connectivity is more needed. Friends, I don't want to go on and on. As I said, governments are relay race. Prabhu Arun called me today here for this gala dinner to speak. I felt very happy. You know, when you are not a minister, you miss such occasions. I'm sorry. You thought about me. No, I'm warning them. After having heard them, I am confident if their tribe increase in their own ministry, there is no scope, only one can be added. So few have to be replaced. India can breach the infrastructure deficit. It needs only three things. Sustained commitment, which Dayanidhi Maran is showing in his sector, or which Praful Patel is showing as far as Delhi and Mumbai airports are concerned. What you need is sustained commitment. Secondly, you need a continuation of policy. Governments may come, governments may go. People don't vote on airports. Who told you? After India shining, again you are telling me that good airports are going to give me votes. Who told you that people vote on telecom? Sir, you took the relay race. I made all these speeches before you. I made Bhikari to carry telephone. But they did not vote for us. And so, governments come, government go. What you need? A continuance of a policy. And thirdly, what you need is some degree of a national consensus as far as the infrastructure policies are concerned. If you have these three things, I am sure that the dream which Dayanidhi is saying, or Praful is saying and trying to fulfill, I wish they will fulfill. If they don't, I will come. Thank you very much.